Cerebral circulation. Now, first of all, in the cerebral circulation, let's understand about the arterial supply to the cerebrum as well as the venous drainage. Now, first of all, the arterial supply in the cerebral circulation, it is from two arteries, internal carotid artery as well as the vertebral artery. Now, two vertebral artery together, it form basilar artery. Basilar artery as well as two internal carotid artery, it form circle of Willis, and circle of Willis, it provides blood supply to the majority of the brain. Now the circle of Willis, it give rise to six large arteries: anterior cerebral artery, middle cerebral artery, and the posterior cerebral artery. Basilar artery, it also gives blood supply to the pons, medulla, as well as the occipital lobes of the brain. And internal carotid artery, it also provides blood supply to the brainstem and parts of the cerebral hemisphere. Now the central branches of the cerebral arteries, these are the end arteries, and the thrombosis or rupture, it invariably causes infarction. And the cortical branches, or the anterior cerebral artery, middle cerebral artery, and the posterior cerebral arteries, these are also known as cortical branches, they form border zone between the area supplied. And these border zones, they are susceptible to ischemic damage, and they are also known as watershed infarcts. Venous drainage in the cerebral circulation is by the veins of the cerebral hemisphere, and they consist of two sets, superficial vein and the deep vein. Now the superficial vein and the deep vein, they anastomose with each other and they are drained in the venous sinuses. And from the venous sinuses, blood it is drained in the internal jugular vein. The vein in the cerebral circulation, they have no valves. And these veins, they are kept open by the structures or the dura around its orifices. Characteristic features of the cerebral blood flow. So the normal blood flow to the brain is 750 ml per minute, or about 50 to 55 ml per 100 gram of the tissue per minute. Now when the cerebral blood flow, it falls below 18 ml per 100 gram of the tissue per minute, then it results in unconsciousness. And that's why it is known as critical flow level. Now the oxygen consumption of the brain is about 50 ml per minute. Whole body consumption of oxygen is 250 ml per minute. So 20% of the whole body oxygen consumption is by the brain. Now this maximum or the high oxygen consumption by the brain, it is because of the presence of the gray matter. Weight of the gray matter is about 1% of the whole body weight. But even after that, due to high capillary density, oxygen consumption of the gray matter, it is high. Brain relies on continuous blood flow for the adequate function. For the energy purpose, brain requires blood glucose. Now, whenever prolonged starvation occurs, then brain can even utilize some amino acids. Blood glucose enters in the brain through the glucose link unit transporters present on the cerebral capillaries, and for this purpose brain doesn't require presence of the insulin. Now brain is most susceptible to ischemia because of the high oxygen consumption. Interruption of the blood flow for only 5 to 10 seconds, it causes loss of consciousness, and circulatory arrest for only 3 to 4 minutes, it results in irreversible brain damage. Factors affecting cerebral blood flow. First factor is the arterial blood pressure. It is the pressure head with which blood enters in the cerebral circulation. Now the cerebral blood flow, it is mainly auto-regulated within the blood pressure range of 65 to 140 millimeter of mercury. That is the mean blood pressure. Second factor is the intracranial pressure or the perfusion pressure. Perfusion pressure is equal to arterial pressure minus venous pressure. And it is the pressure exerted on the vessels inside the brain. Third is the resistance. Whenever resistance increases, it decreases the blood flow. And resistance, it depends on the viscosity of the blood. And the fourth factor is the diameter of the cerebral blood vessels. So vasodilatation, it increases the cerebral blood flow, and vasoconstriction, it decreases the cerebral blood flow. Now let's understand auto-regulation of the cerebral blood flow. Cerebral blood flow, it remains nearly constant in the range of mean blood pressure of 60 to 140 millimeter of mercury, and this regulation is known as autoregulation of the cerebral blood flow. Autoregulation of the cerebral blood flow, it can be explained by metabolic theory and the myogenic theory. First of all, let's understand about the myogenic theory of the regulation of the cerebral blood flow. So whenever cerebral blood flow increases immediately, then it produces stretch in the walls of the blood vessels. Now stretch in the walls of the blood vessel, it produces stretch on the smooth muscle present in the walls of the vessels. Now stretching of the smooth muscle, it produces increase in the permeability for the calcium, and increase in the permeability of the calcium, it produces contraction of the smooth muscle. Now contraction of this smooth muscle produces constriction of the vessel, and constriction of the vessel decreases the blood flow. And this theory is known as myogenic theory. Metabolic regulation of the cerebral blood flow. So blood flow to the individual segment of the brain, it changes with a change in the neuronal activity, and this change in the blood flow, it is related to the change in the metabolism. For example, while reading, blood flow to the occipital area increases. While making a fist, blood flow to the motor cortex of the opposite side increases. So because of the increase in the metabolism, it produces increase in the metabolic factors which can increase the cerebral blood flow. Now the important metabolic factors which play important role in the cerebral blood flow, they are carbon dioxide, partial pressure of the oxygen, and the potassium ions. So whenever metabolism of the segment of the brain increases, then it increases the production of the carbon dioxide as well as the potassium ions, and decrease in the partial pressure of the oxygen in that segment, it act as a vasodilator substances, and they increase blood flow to that segment of the brain. And this regulation, it is known as metabolic regulation. Carbon dioxide is most potent vasodilator of the cerebral blood vessel. Carbon dioxide, it can cross blood-brain barrier. It combines with the water and forms H2CO3, which dissociates in H+ and HCO3-. So it increases H+ in the CSF, and it can produce vasodilatation. Now here we can see the recording of the arterial pressure and the cerebral blood flow, and the effect of the carbon dioxide on the cerebral blood flow. Here we can see the record of the partial pressure of the carbon dioxide of 70 mmHg and PCO2 of 40 mmHg. So first of all, let's understand the normal PCO2 at the 40 mmHg. What is the effect on the cerebral blood flow? So as we can see in the chart, at the PCO2 of 40 mmHg, usually blood flow, it is auto-regulated within the blood pressure range of 60 to 140 mmHg. And this is known as auto-regulation of the cerebral blood flow. And when partial pressure of the carbon dioxide, it increases beyond 40 mmHg, then gradually cerebral blood flow increases. Now with increase in the PCO2, cerebral blood flow increases, but it is up to 80 mmHg. Because at the PCO2 of 80 mmHg, all the cerebral blood vessels, they are maximally dilated, so beyond which it can no further increase the cerebral blood flow. So cerebral blood flow, it is auto-regulated within the range of 60 to 160 mmHg, and whenever mean blood pressure decreases less than 60 mmHg, then it decreases the blood flow to various parts of the brain. Now whenever blood flow to the vasomotor center decreases, then it activates last ditch stand or CNS ischemic response. CNS ischemic response, it produces strong activation of the sympathetic discharge, which can increases blood pressure and the blood flow to various parts of the brain. Now let's understand Monroe-Kelly doctrine and the Cushing reflex. According to the Monroe-Kelly doctrine, cranial cavity, it contains various volumes like brain volume, arterial blood, venous blood, and the CSF, and all these volumes, they are always constant. Whenever change in one or two volume occur, it always occur at the compensation of other two volumes. Whenever intracranial mass, intracranial injury, or intracranial hemorrhage occurs, it increases the intracranial pressure. Increase in the intracranial pressure, it produces compression over the cerebral blood vessel, which decreases the blood flow. Whenever blood flow to the vasomotor area decreases, it initiates CNS ischemic response, and CNS ischemic response, through the strong sympathetic output, it produces hypertension. Now this increase in the blood pressure in the systemic circulation, it is sensed by baroreceptor. And baroreceptor, through the baroreceptor reflex, it produces bradycardia. Because of the decrease in the sympathetic as well as increase in the parasympathetic output to the pacemaker tissue. So whenever intracranial injury occurs, it produces hypertension associated with bradycardia, and this reflex, it is known as Cushing reflex. Changes in the intracranial pressure, it can change venous pressure and perfusion pressure, which can alter blood flow. For example, whenever intracranial pressure increases, then it can compress the cerebral blood vessel, which can decrease perfusion pressure and decreases the blood flow. Now let's understand gravitational effects and their effect on the intracranial pressure. First of all, the positive gravitational effect. So whenever body accelerates upwards, then blood moves towards the lower limbs, and these are the positive gravitational factors. So whenever positive gravitational factors, they are in the force, then it causes peripheral pooling of the blood. Now this peripheral pooling of the blood decreases the venous return and decreases the cardiac output. So arterial pressure at the level of the head decreases. This decreases the intracranial pressure. So positive gravitational forces, they can cause blackout. Now let's understand negative gravitational effects. So whenever body accelerates downwards, then force acting towards the head, they increase. And these are the negative gravitational forces. This increases blood flow towards the brain, and this increases the intracranial pressure. So cerebral vessels, they are supported and they do not rupture. And negative gravitational forces, they cause redout. Applied aspect, syncope. So syncope, it refers to transient fainting or the loss of the consciousness. So this transient loss of the consciousness is because of the momentary but significant decrease in the cerebral blood flow. So decrease in the cerebral blood flow can result in the loss of consciousness, which is known as syncope. Now syncope, it may be because of the cardiogenic or the non-cardiogenic causes. Causes of the syncope. So syncope, it may be due to cardiogenic, non-cardiogenic or the metabolic causes. First of all, cardiogenic causes. So these are all the causes because of the disease process inside the heart. So whenever obstruction to the cardiac output, for example, because of the aortic stenosis, it can result in the decrease in the cardiac output and syncope. Cardiac arrhythmias, it can produce ineffective contraction of the myocardium and it produces decrease in the cardiac output. Cardiac arrhythmias, either because of the heart block or Stock-Adams syndrome, it can produce decrease in the cardiac output and the cardiogenic syncope. Myocardial infarction, it can also lead to decrease in the cardiac output because of the infarction of the portion of the myocardium. So this is also a cardiogenic cause for the syncope. Now the non-cardiogenic syncope. Non-cardiogenic syncope, it can be because of the vasovagal syncope, in which strong stimulation of the vagus nerve and the parasympathetic output, it can decrease cardiac output and it can produce transient unconsciousness. Postural syncope, it is because of the decrease in the sympathetic output with a change in the posture, which can decrease cerebral blood flow and it can produce syncope. Valsalva manoeuvre, it can also produce syncope because of the increase in the intrathoracic pressure, which decreases the venous return, and it results in the decrease in the cerebral blood flow. Now the metabolic syncope, it is because of the hyperventilation as well as the hypoglycemia. Hypoglycemia decreases the blood glucose, and decrease in the blood glucose decreases the fuel supply to the brain, which can result in the syncope. Hyperventilation, it decreases the partial pressure of the carbon dioxide in the blood, which can produce vasoconstriction in the cerebral blood vessel, decreases the cerebral blood flow, which can lead to syncope. Now let's solve some MCQs from this topic. First MCQ, autoregulation of blood flow to the cerebrum is from 65 to 140 millimeter of mercury. Second MCQ, vasodilatation produced by the carbon dioxide is maximum in. So vasodilatation produced by the carbon dioxide is maximum in brain. The most important factor for regulating cerebral blood flow in normal condition is rate of cerebral carbon dioxide formation. So increase in the cerebral carbon dioxide formation, it increases the blood flow. Up to partial pressure carbon dioxide of 80 mmHg, it can increase blood flow, because at partial pressure of 80 mmHg, it produces maximum vasodilatation and maximum increase in the blood flow, beyond which it can no further increase the cerebral blood flow. Characteristic feature and factors affecting the cutaneous circulation. Now, first of all, characteristic features of the cutaneous blood flow. Metabolic rate of the skin is relatively small. So the main function of the cutaneous blood flow, it is the regulation of body temperature. Now, resting cutaneous blood flow, it is about 10 to 15 ml per minute per 100 gram of the skin tissue. Now, the blood vessels in the skin, they are under the hypothalamic control of the basal myogenic tone. Whenever basal myogenic tone increases, it produces vasoconstriction, and whenever basal myogenic tone decreases, it produces dilatation of the vessel or the vasodilatation. Now, during the exposure to the cold, because of the vasoconstriction, blood flow to the skin decreases up to 1 ml per minute per 100 gram of the tissue, and during the exposure to the heat, blood flow to the skin increases because of the dilatation of the blood vessels, and blood flow increases up to 150 ml per minute per 100 gram of the tissue. Regional variation, it is also present in the different parts of the skin, like hand, feet, ear lobes, they contain AV anastomosis, and in this area blood flow increases more than the rest of the skin area. Basal metabolism of skin is small, and oxygen consumption is only 0.3 ml per minute per 100 gram of the tissue. Cutaneous blood flow, it is predominantly regulated by the neural control mechanism instead of the metabolic control mechanisms. Now let's understand neural supply to the cutaneous blood vessels. So the cutaneous blood vessels, they are richly innervated by the sympathetic vasoconstrictor nerves, and this sympathetic vasoconstrictor nerves, they tonically influence the contraction of vessels in the skin, and this is known as vasoconstrictor tone. This vasoconstrictor sympathetic tonic discharge, it is more marked on the AV anastomosis vessels. Parasympathetic vasodilator nerves, they do not supply cutaneous blood vessels. So vasodilatation occurs in the cutaneous blood vessels whenever sympathetic tonic discharge decreases, or there is release of the local metabolites or kinins. They can produce dilatation in the vessels in the skin. Now let's understand factors affecting cutaneous blood flow. First is the exposure to the cold stress. So whenever body is exposed to the severe cold, then through the hypothalamic mechanism, sympathetic discharge increases. Because of the increase in the sympathetic discharge to the sympathetic vasoconstrictor nerves in the blood vessels in the skin, it produces constriction of the blood vessel. So vasoconstriction decreases the blood flow to the skin. It decreases the metabolic rate of the tissue and decreases the supply of nutrients in the skin. So exposure to the cold, it decreases blood flow to the skin and decreases heat loss from the body. Now whenever exposure to the severe cold occurs, it decreases the skin temperature less than 10 degrees centigrade. It leads to tissue injury, and because of the tissue injury, it leads to release of the histamine. Now this released histamine, it stimulates sensory nerve terminals, and through this sensory nerve terminals, it activates axon reflex, and it releases substance P, which dilates blood vessel, and this dilatation of the blood vessel, it is known as cold vasodilatation. Prolonged exposure to the cold also increases the plasma kinin formation. So this cold vasodilatation as well as the plasma kinin formation, it leads to inflammatory changes. So prolonged exposure to the cold in the damp condition, it produces skin lesion, and it is known as trench foot. Now let's understand what happens when body is exposed to the heat stress. So whenever body is exposed to the heat stress, then it decreases the sympathetic discharge. So whenever sympathetic discharge is abolished or it is decreased, it leads to decrease in the basal myogenic tone or the vasoconstrictor tone in the skin vessels, which leads to dilatation of the vessels and dilatation of the AV anastomosis. Now the vasodilatation in the skin, it increases the blood flow in the skin, and this increase in the blood flow leads to heat loss from the body. Emotions affect cutaneous circulation through the corticohypothalamic pathway. First, the blenching of the skin. Blenching of the skin occurs during situations like fear, when sympathetic output increases via cortical mechanism. This increase in the sympathetic output, it produces vasoconstriction, and decrease in the blood flow to the skin produces blenching of skin. Blushing or emotional embarrassment, it occurs because of the vasodilatation in the skin, and it occurs because of the bradykinin release secondary to sympathetic cholinergic discharge to the sweat glands, which produces vasodilatation and it produces blushing. Cutaneous vascular response or triple response, it was explained by Lewis T. in 1927. It is a three-part response of the normal reaction to the injury. So whenever skin is struck firmly with a pointed instrument, then it produces red reaction, flare and wheal. Now the red reaction, it is produced because of the dilatation of the precapillary sphincters. And the dilatation of the precapillary sphincter occurs because of the release of the histamine or the bradykinin from the damaged skin. The flare is the diffusely spreading and the irregularly outlined redness surrounding the red line. It is because of the dilatation of the arterioles, terminal arterioles, as well as the precapillary sphincters. Flare occurs because of the axon reflex, which is mediated by the sensory terminals of the C fibers, which releases substance P, which produces vasodilatation. It is abolished by the local anesthetics. Wheal is swelling or localized edema that develops within the area of flare. It occurs because of the increase in the capillary permeability. And this increase in the capillary permeability is because of the release of the substance P, histamine and calcitonin gene related peptide. So this increase in the capillary permeability, it causes transudation of the fluid out of the capillary, which contains some amount of the protein, which produces localized edema.